place. It's running in residential homes.
Through the course, people are being settled in their faith, understanding the fundamentals of the gospel.
This is about Jesus getting onto the streets in people's lives right where they are.
And God uses it, I think, in ways that we don't really plan at the beginning.
The one thing that unites all those different places is the stories of the people whose lives have been transformed by Jesus Christ.
Something was missing in my life and I didn't know what it was. And while I was on the Alpha course, I just came to this epiphany that I wasn't alone out there.
Just being in a room with a group of people who are basically looking for the same thing, more out of life.
The Alpha course actually taught me that life wasn't meant to be lived alone and that community was very important. And Jesus actually, through his love, was able to change my life by telling me, you're much more than just a work person. You are someone that I created. You are someone wonderfully made, and you are someone that I love. And that to me now is what I want to live for.
The difference that Christ has made in my life was absolutely another step in life-changing moments.
Good morning. Nice to see a bunch of saints sitting here this morning, ready to enjoy a sermon. The Bible says that everybody who accepts Jesus as a savior is a saint. Some churches you have to earn it. But we're saints if he's our savior. So I hope there's everybody here is, and if they're not, those two words, I believe, would be lovely to hear today. Jesus, fill this church with your love and your caring. Bless everyone who's sitting here today. May the message go deep in their hearts. May they hear about Jesus. And may that make them a better person. If you don't know him, you need to have him in your heart. He loves each and every one of you. And thank you for coming this morning and being a part of this wonderful family. I pray in the name of Christ. Amen.
In the blood of the Lamb. Amen. Thank you, choir. Yes, I am. And we pray that all of us, as Jim had said, here as well. Well, the ushers were kind enough to offer me a bulletin, and I said, no thanks, I have one. And there it is. I do have one. Well, welcome to Hibbing Alliance Church. We are so glad to have you here. We are here to prayerfully build relationships so that we can impact lives with the transforming power of Jesus Christ for the growth of God's kingdom. And that is what we're about. Now, if you got your bulletin, you have a ton of announcements, and I'm not going to read them all to you. I know that our congregation is super intelligent, and they can read all by themselves. But I do want to highlight one thing, and that is that annual reports, because we have an annual meeting in February, the annual reports are due today. And I just want to highlight also, you saw the Alpha film. Alpha is going to be happening again. Those announcements are in your bulletin. It's going to be in a home this time, but if you want to invite someone and bring someone to an Alpha course where they can be introduced to Jesus Christ in a very, very non-confrontational or challenging way, but rather a way that they get to see from the Spirit's perspective the greatness and glory of God, talk to Marcia. You had a question? Can you use your microphone?
I think it's in the bulletin as a fifth. We made a decision because it's Super Bowl Sunday that we are changing the starting date to the 12th.
All right, thank you. Other announcements in your bulletin, please read those, okay? And respond accordingly. We'd like your participation and active role in serving the Lord as we prayerfully build relationships to impact lives with the transforming power of Jesus Christ for the growth of God's kingdom. With that being said, will the ushers please come forward as we begin to worship the Lord together in song as we sing together the Lion of Judah. But we're going to pray first. Get up. Come on, get up. These guys are over there. No, I appreciate the work that they do. Let's pray together. Father God, we come before you with the joy of knowing that salvation is available to everyone. That, Father, it does take the admission of the fact that you are the Son of God, God incarnate, that you are the Savior of the world. We do need to surrender to you and repent of our sins. But, Father, that anyone can do that. It does not matter how evil they may see themselves or others may see them. You are a God that transforms and changes darkness to light and from death to life. So as we continue to talk about the transforming power and work of Jesus Christ, we pray, God, that you will open our hearts and our minds to hear your truth from the Word of God. Father, we pray for James Casto, who used to be a part of our congregation, as he will be attending his mom's memorial service this Friday. Give him safety and his wife safety as they travel up from Frazee. Be with his sister, Lord, who's planning the ceremony. And God, we just pray that you will be with all that are involved in this memorial service, that even though they're grieving, and we want them to grieve, Lord, in a healthy fashion, let them hear the truth, the love of you have for them in the midst of their sorrow. Open up hope, I pray. Lord, we pray for these Hibbing police officers that were involved in the shooting over the weekend. Lord, you never intended for us, and we aren't built to willfully want to hurt someone. And so, Lord, when that happens, it does something to the emotions and the mind. So I pray for these officers that are involved. I pray for their families. I pray for the entire police department, Lord, as it affects the entire police family. Help them to know, Father, that people care about them, that people appreciate what they do for us. And God, I pray your Holy Spirit will speak safety into the lives of each one of these people, especially those involved in the shooting. And we pray for the suspect, Father. Pray that his life is not taken. We pray, God, that he will recover. And pray, Lord, that you will sort out the justice that needs to happen in a situation like this. We do ask, Father, that you will be with our community, as we have seen in the last year or so an increase in violent crime. Help us, Lord, as a church in this community, as well as other Christian churches, to have an influence that will bring peace, that we will see a revival because people are surrendering their life to Jesus and you are transforming them from evil to righteousness. Be with those that want to be here but can't because of health or other reasons. Watch over them, Lord, and bring safety to them and bring healing to their bodies, those that are feeling the brokenness of their health. And God, just be blessed as we continue to worship you in spirit and truth, and the giving of our offerings and the offering of music and finances and the offering of ourselves and worship and prayer. God be glorified, I pray, in the name of Jesus Christ our Lord.
You're the Lion of Judah, the Lamb who was slain. You ascended to heaven and evermore will reign. At the end of the age, when the earth you reclaim, you will gather the nations before you. And the eyes of all men will be fixed on the Lamb who was crucified. With wisdom and mercy and justice you'll reign at your Father's side. And the angels will cry, Hail the Lamb, who was slain for the world, rule in power. And the earth will reply, You shall reign as the King of all kings and the Lord of all lords. There's a shield in our hand and a sword at our side. There's a fire in our spirit that cannot be denied. Cause the Father has told us, for these you have died, for the nations who gather before you. And the ears of all men need to hear of the Lamb who was crucified, who descended to hell and was raised up to reign at his Father's side. And the angels will cry, Hail the Lamb, who was slain for the world, will reply, You shall reign as the King of all kings and the Lord of all lords. And the angels will cry, Hail the Lamb who was slain for the world, rule in power. And the earth will reply, The King of all kings and the Lord of all lords.
Hallelujah, Jesus. Yes. Amen. Amen.
I believe in Jesus. I believe He is the Son of God. I believe He died and rose again. I believe He paid for us all. And I believe He's here now.
I believe He's here now.
Standing in our power to heal now, and the grace to forgive. I believe in Jesus. I believe He is the Son of God. I believe He died and rose again. I believe He paid for us all. darkness. Here with the power to heal now. And the grace to forgive. I believe in you, Lord. I believe you are the Son of God. I believe you died and rose again. I believe you paid for us all. And I believe you are here now. In our midst, here with the power to heal now, and the grace to forgive. And I believe you are here now.
I believe you are here now.
Standing in our midst, here with the power.
Rejected and alone.
above all, crucified and laid behind the stone. You lived and died, rejected and alone, like a rose trampled on the ground. You took the fall and thought of me above all, like a rose trampled on the ground. You took the fall and thought of me above all.
Hallelujah, Jesus. Thank you, Father, that you did think of us. That God, you loved us so much that you sent your only begotten Son so that we might know redemption for everlasting to everlasting. We might have relationship reconciled with you, O Father, through your Son. Praise your holy name. Amen. You may be seated. We are just launching or beginning, started last week, a series on the year of transformation, which we are proclaiming for us as a congregation. As we launch into 2017, I want to challenge all of us to accept this year as the year of transformation. In other words, personally look and evaluate our life and our relationship with God in all aspects of our living, and are we being transformed? Is how we carry out business, how we carry out our workplace, how we do shopping, how we have conversations, how we meet the dentist, and all these kind of things, are all of it demonstrating the transformation that we have in Jesus Christ. So that we fulfill the Apostle Paul's words in Romans that talks about the fact that we are not to be conformed to this world, but to be transformed by the renewing of our mind. And when our mind is renewed, then our character and our conduct and our how we carry out life is renewed. The filter of how we look at things is transformed and renewed. So much so that it would be then the concept of renewal and transformation is not I, but Christ. Not me, but Christ. Not my way, but Christ. Not my attitude, but Christ's. Not my traditions, whether they be church traditions or other traditions, but Christ's. Not my ego, but Christ. Not my leadership methods, but Christ. Not my territory, but Christ. And we can go on and on and on, but ultimately it's all about Christ. For that to be true in one's life requires a spiritual transformation. You and I can say that. But how we are viewed by others in terms of do we look like Christ? Do we act like Christ? Do people see us and go, man, if anyone would be Jesus with skin on today, that would be the person. That's the transformation we are all looking for and that God expects. So the text for the series that we are in is the book of Colossians. We ended last Sunday with these two verses in Colossians chapter 1. For this reason also, since the day we heard of it, we have not ceased to pray for you and to ask that you may be filled with the knowledge of His will in all spiritual wisdom and understanding, so that you will walk in a manner worthy of the Lord, to please Him in all respects, bearing fruit in every good work and increasing in the knowledge of God, semicolon. So we literally ended in mid-sentence. So I want to pick up where we left off. It says, so that you will walk in a manner worthy of the Lord and to please Him in all respects, bearing fruit in every good work and increasing in the knowledge of God, strengthened with all power, according to his glorious might, for the attaining of all steadfastness and patience, joyously giving to the Father, who has qualified us to share in the inheritance of the saints in light. For he rescued us from the domain of darkness and transferred us to the kingdom of his beloved Son, in whom we have redemption, the forgiveness of sins. He, Jesus, is the image of the invisible God, the firstborn of all creation. For by him all things were created, both in heaven and on earth, visible and invisible, whether thrones or dominions or rulers or authorities. All things have been created through him and for him. He is before all things, and in him all things hold together. He is also head of the body, the church. He is the beginning, the firstborn from the dead, so that he himself will come to have first place in everything. I'm going to add these verses because I'll make reference to them in a few moments. For it was by the Father's good pleasure for all the fullness to dwell in him, and through him to reconcile all things to himself, having made peace through the blood of his cross. Through him, I say, whether things on earth or things in heaven. And those last two verses we'll talk more about next Sunday. What we're looking at then, just a reminder, if you weren't here last week, the church in Colossae, the Christian church, had an issue that many of the Christian churches, the new founded Christian churches, had in the Middle East, and that is that they embraced Christianity, they embraced Jesus as Savior, they embraced that Jesus is God, but they also hung on to some of their foreign belief systems. So the word is syncretism, where you add multiple religions or multiple concepts into one ball, if you will. So the core was salvation in Jesus Christ. And the church, Paul even wrote earlier, and we saw that last week, where he thanked them and he expressed the joy that they were in Christ Jesus. They were a part of the family of God. But what he wanted to speak to, and the rest of the Colossians, is this, is that you have melded into Christianity things that don't belong there. You've brought in Eastern mysticism. You've brought in Greek philosophy. You've brought in legalism. You've brought in the law, practicing it in the old method rather than now that we're liberated in Christ. You've brought in all these other things to the point that you have even set up laws that are to punish people if they don't walk a certain way or do a certain thing. Monks back in the 16th century carried on this practice in some regards when they would take whips, and when they had an impure thought, they would whip themselves until they bled because they felt that way God would be pleased. What God wants to do is purify the mind, not just beat up the body. And so the credentials of Christ, Paul wanted to establish, and we looked at it last week a little bit. We're going to look at it again this week, because this is the foundation for the rest of the book of Colossians and for all Christianity, are what are the credentials of Jesus Christ. So even though I started with verse 9, we're going to go jump down a little bit to verse 13 to start with the credentials. Some of the terminology or adjectives, other words that we could use for Jesus is Savior, Redeemer, Victor. In the book called The Message, which is a paraphrase of scriptures, in verse 13 and 14, it's written this way: for everything, absolutely everything, above and below, visible and invisible, rank after rank after rank of angels, everything got started in him and finds its purpose in him, meaning Jesus. He was supreme in the beginning and leading the resurrection parade. He is supreme in the end. From the beginning to end, he's there, towering far above everything and everyone. So spacious is he, so roomy, that everything of God finds its proper place in him without crowding. Not only that, but all the broken and dislocated pieces of the universe, people and things, animals and atoms, great properly fixed and fitted together in vibrant harmonies, and because of his death, his blood is poured down from the cross. It is this in a nutshell: Christ in you. Therefore, you can look forward to sharing in God's glory. It's that simple. That is the substance of our message. We preach Christ. The Apostle Paul, again, is talking. I'm going to switch because we're getting this pop, pop, pop all day long. Grab this over here. I'm on the red, blue.
That's code for you guys that are out there. Are we up yet? Yep. Okay, good. So here you have the Apostle Paul, and he's trying to play this out. And when we go through Colossians, we're going to go through a lot of different aspects of our lives. Okay? And he's going to talk about reminding us to the foundation is Jesus. The foundation of Jesus is in service, is in working, is in being a boss, it's in being an employee, it's being a husband, it's being a wife. And he goes through all that in the book of Colossians. We're going to look at that because we are talking about the year of transformation, which means that we who are followers of Christ should be remarkably different than how the world does it. Profoundly different, so it represents Christ and his glory to all people. George Barna is a Christian pollster. He has this quote referring to the boomers. Now, I know of late, boomers having a great, we're having a good time beating up on the millennials. Okay? The millennials are people that are born like, I don't know, 20 years ago. Okay? They're in their teens and early 20s, okay? Or up maybe 30. Okay, that's the millennials. And boomers are the people that were their parents, basically. Okay, some were born between like 45 and 65 or something like that. I don't know what it was. But it's that group. It's me. Okay? It's most of you are boomers, okay? That age group are referred to as boomers. This is the generation that was the flower child. This is the generation that said, you know, we don't need anything but love and protesting the war. This is the boomers, okay? Well, now we're about to pass off our leadership to others, okay? So get off the mic. Is that what he's saying? Okay? And so the boomers are the parents now that are living out the result of their parenting, which is the millennials or the grandkids, okay? And so even though we're beating up on them and going, here's what I hear. Because I remember when I was a kid, my parents would say, they're called the generations or something like that, the greatest generation, okay? I remember my parents going, these kids today. It's not like when I was a kid. What are the boomers saying? We never wanted to be like mom and dad. What are we saying? These kids today. Okay, it just keeps going on. All right? So this is what George Barna says about the boomers. So this is most of us here that are between, you know, 40-ish to beyond. Okay? It said, at the heart, boomers are consumers. And the way we presented Christ to most boomers struck a resonant chord with them from the mindset. We told them all they had to do was say a prayer, admitting they made some mistakes, they're sorry, and they want to be forgiven. Boomers weighed in the downside, which really amounted to nothing more than a one-time admission of imperfection and weakness in return for permanent peace with God. Figured it was a no-brainer, a can't-lose transaction. The consequence has been millions of boomers who said the prayer, asked for forgiveness, went on with their way of life with virtually nothing changed, aka no transformation. And I remember this vividly as a kid growing up, and you would hear from the pulpits, and I have been guilty of this early in my ministry, we would just say, you know what? Just admit you're a sinner, pray and ask God to forgive you of your sins, salvation's free, and you get to go to heaven. And the boomer generation is going, sounds pretty good to me. Hey, God, I'm a sinner. I accept you as my Savior. And off I go. I get to go to heaven. Now I'm living under this false sense of security because my life has not been transformed. I have not surrendered to the Creator of the universe, to the Savior of the universe. I've only said the prayer, and now I'm in. And the book of Matthew has words about that. It says, not everyone who says, Lord, Lord, will enter the kingdom of heaven. It isn't about the words, it's about the surrender. And so the evangelical church has been extremely guilty in the boomer generation of telling people, hey, just say these words. All you got to do is repeat these words, and you're in. And it's a surrender. It's a recognition of the evil we've been a part of. It's a surrender to Jesus to take away that evil, but now I'm going to follow you and the way you live, and you want me to live in you. What was happening in Colossae, what's happening in the Christian churches of today, is that we're walking in this boomer mentality, if you will, and we've passed it along to our kids in some regards, and said, if you just say these words, you get to go to heaven. And you've heard me say this before, but I'll say it again. Heaven is not what we're supposed to be looking toward. It is reconciling with God the Father, because we are separated from sin. And only the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus can redeem us from that sin. And so if your prayer was all about getting into heaven, you were deceived by well-intended people. Heaven is a place where God dwells. But God wants to dwell with us right now, here in us, now and for all eternity. So the first name that we looked at was Savior, Redeemer, and Victor. And in Christ, when we surrender to Christ and abandon our own selfish pursuits, and allow him to save us, but also lead us, then Jesus is indeed our victor and our savior. Jesus is also referred to as fully God, creator, eternal, Lord. In verses 15 and 16 of Colossians, it says, he is the image of the invisible God, the firstborn of all creation, for by him all things were created, referring to Jesus. In other words, as a part of the God, head, he is at creation, creating both in the heavens and on earth, visible and invisible, whether thrones or dominions or rulers or authorities, all things have been created through him and for him. He is omnipotent, omnipresent, omniscient. Omnipotence means he is all powerful. Omnipresent means he is everywhere present at the same time. He is omniscient, means he is all-knowing. Well, he created everything. He knows everything about it. He is holy, without sin. He is the King. He is Lord. He is Master. Verses 17 through 18, referring to Jesus, he is before all things, and in him all things hold together. In other words, the centrality of Christ holds the things in the world together. He is the head of the body, the church. He is the beginning. He is the firstborn from the dead, so that he himself will come to have first place in everything. In other words, it is all about Jesus. I want to read for you. I'm going to put these on first. A little section from this book by David Bryant. It's called Christ is All. It's talking about the supremacy of Christ. It's a little lengthy, but not too bad. It's just on one page, and it's not the whole page, but please follow along. I'm gonna change his metaphor just a tad, okay? Because he talks about a slide projector, and it's like, yeah, who knows about those that are in the millennial generation. I was talking to a gal yesterday that's a cadet, and I mentioned a rotary phone. She looked at me like, what in the world are you talking about? So I'm going to change the metaphor just a bit. Okay, here's another metaphor to make sense of this truth. Consider a slide projector or one of these machines above my head. Though we have many pictures to review and we see many pictures through that projector, just one bulb is needed to project each of them onto the screen. In the same way, there are thousands of hope-filled passages in the Bible, but just one person is needed to make those truths burst into life. Only one person comes shining through every verse, revealing more of his supremacy every time he does. The whole of Scripture is one book, and that one book is Christ, concluded medieval Christian leader Hugh of St. Victor. Martin Luther said, "The Bible is the cradle in which Christ is laid." William Tyndale said, "The Scriptures spring out of God and flow into Christ." In fact, the Scriptures nurture a cornucopia of descriptive names that suggest how Jesus is seen when projected through a myriad of God's promises, such as Jesus is the way, the truth, the rock, day spring from on high, son of righteousness, light of the world, bread of life. Jesus is the light, the bright morning star, prince of peace, good shepherd, lion of Judah, Alpha and Omega, name above all names. And we could list literally 100 other formal titles that God's word bestows on our Lord. In other words, our God-given prospects are tied up so comprehensively in this one person that the Bible requires an entire registry to define how and why he is, to use another title, the hope of glory. Jesus is God. He is King. He is the hope of glory. He is the centrality of all everlasting life. C.S. Lewis, author of Mere Christianity and other books, including The Tales of Narnia, which are 6 books that actually explore the implications of the supremacy of Christ through a child's view, said this regarding Jesus: "You must make your choice. Either this man, Jesus, was and is the Son of God, or else a madman, or something worse. You can shut him up for a fool. You can spit at him and kill him as a demon. Or you can fall at his feet and call him Lord and God." That's his credentials. We see in the Scriptures the completeness that's found in Christ. If you look back at those verses in chapters 9 through 18, you hear these words. "I am here to be filled." Jesus says, "I want to be filled up." You should be filled up with the hope of his glory. Jesus is our all in all. And it goes on and mentions his all. He is all. He is all. We want to know all about Christ. To give you just a few of those examples. "For this reason, since the day we heard of it, we have not ceased to pray for you to ask that you may be filled with the knowledge of his will and all spiritual wisdom, all respects of his manner of goodness and bearing fruit, all steadfastness, all power, all creation, all things, all things, all things, all things." And he keeps repeating that. What the Apostle Paul wanted for the church in Colossae and what God wanted through that letter to all of us is that we would know the fullness of who Jesus Christ is in our own personal life. That we would be transformed from what we were into something completely different, the image of Jesus Christ himself, the fullness of his glory. So in the Scriptures, we read that he's filled, that we are to be filled. We are to experience his allness, if you will. St. Patrick, and I have to admit, it shows I didn't know my church history that well. St. Patrick was not Irish. Did you know that? He was British. He was robbed from his home by Celtic warriors from Britain and brought to Ireland as a slave. And I think it was at age 16, he escaped from his captors and went back to Britain and then encountered Christ, became a priest, and went back to Ireland as a missionary to the Irish people. Had nothing to do with snakes except that ugly snake Satan. That's the only one he worked against, okay? If you talk to Irish people, their patron saint, the one that they appreciate the most, is St. Patrick. And yet, if you talk to them about Britain, they don't like British that much. And yet, their patron saint is actually British. because of the impact that Patrick had in his missionary work in Ireland. This is a quote from St. Patrick when he talked about his devotion to Jesus Christ and why he served in this country that captured him and made him a slave. He said, "Christ with me, Christ before me, Christ behind me, Christ in me, Christ beneath me, Christ above me, Christ on my right, and Christ on my left, Christ when I lie down, Christ when I sit down, Christ when I arise, Christ in the heart of every man who thinks of me, Christ in the mouth of everyone who speaks of me, Christ in every eye that sees me, Christ in every ear that hears me." What was Patrick saying? It's all about Christ. We are changed by Christ. In Colossians 1:9-12, going back to the beginning of the portion of Scripture we read, "For this reason also, since the day we heard of it, we have not ceased to pray for you and to ask that you would be filled with the knowledge of his will in all spiritual wisdom and understanding, that you would walk in a manner worthy of the Lord to please him in all respects, bearing fruit in every good work and increasing in the knowledge of God, strengthened with all power according to his glorious might, for the attaining of all steadfastness and patience, joyously giving thanks to the Father who has qualified us to share in the inheritance of the saints in light," capital L, meaning Jesus. That passage of Scripture talks about that we are to be changed by Christ in the knowledge of spiritual wisdom and understanding. The Bible talks about more than once in both the Old and New Testament the mystery of the Word of God, the greatness of God, that he is so powerful, he is so mighty, he is so amazing, we can't begin to understand him. But we must accept him and love him by faith. That we would be so transformed that Christ would be in us in daily activity. That we would have growth in service and knowledge of our Lord Jesus Christ. That we would be empowered by Christ for endurance. And that we would come with joyous, with thanksgiving to the Christ, to be Christ's follower. We would count it to be joyous with thanksgiving to be Christ's follower. Dr. John Armstrong authored a book called The Glory of Christ, and he wrote this: "Anyone who believes that Jesus is Lord cannot avoid the implications of such a confession in every sphere of life. This is clearly one reason why the early Christians suffered and died. They dared to challenge the political authority of Rome by saying Jesus is Lord. They did not defy Rome's every law, but they did refuse to say anyone but Jesus is Lord." And if you remember your Roman history at all, Caesars claimed themselves to be gods or lords. They, with joy, expressed their devotion to Jesus, even though it cost them their life. And then finally, we are identified as a disciple of Christ, considering us qualified because of Christ in us to share in the inheritance of the saints in light. It is about Christ, all the things we're going to be discussing, because when we start getting to them, humanity is going to want to rise up in us and say, "Well, not that. Don't ask me, God, to give that up. Don't ask me to change in that way. I kind of like the way I am about this." And we hear things like above reproach. Say, "Well, that's pretty hard." But Christ in us is the hope of glory. So who or what do you identify with? The church at Colossae pursued Christ and mysticism and philosophy, self-imposed laws and legalism, and rather than believe Jesus is all in all, that he is all sufficient. We don't need anything else but Jesus. God incarnate, the only way, the truth, and life. They felt they needed to augment or substitute Jesus with something else, as though Jesus were not enough. But the Apostle Paul wrote to Colossae, also wrote to the troubled church in Corinth, these words in 2 Corinthians 11, 2 and 3. Speaking of God, "For I am jealous for you with a godly jealousy. For I betrothed you to one husband, so that to Christ I might present you as a pure virgin." The church, talking about the bride of Christ. "But I am afraid that, as the serpent deceived Eve by his craftiness, your minds will be led astray from the simplicity and purity of devotion to Christ." My friends, true transformation requires a total surrender to the person of Jesus Christ, the Lordship of Jesus Christ. Nothing added. Christ is all. And as we get into this transformed life, that's the foundation I want us all to fall back on. Christ is all. He's all we need. He is all. Okay? Now, I guarantee that you will be challenged. And I will be challenged in this fullness of Christ. Because I will go out on a limb here and say that our congregation, as wonderful as it is, has yet to experience the true fullness of Christ as individuals or as a congregation. We still hang on to some of those things. We still have our traditions. We might even pull in some things. "Hey, I heard something on the radio today. That sounds pretty good." And it's not what God wants. He wants Christ in us, as Patrick said, through us, in front of us, behind us, over us, under us, when I rise up, when I sit down, when I lie down, Christ in me. That when people talk about Kevin Norton, I would hope, as St. Patrick said, that they don't talk about me, they talk about Christ. And I think St. Patrick, if he really could roll in his grave, when St. Patrick's Day comes up and says, sees the revelry among Western cultures that celebrate that holiday and pour, you know, green into the bay and that kind of thing and have this beer mongers and all that stuff, he would be sick, because it's not any longer about Christ. It's about celebrating a guy that's a legend and then having a party to do it. Christ in me, the hope of glory. Worship team, will you come? As we go to prayer this morning, I was given a note. Israel, as you know, has a very strong connection in our faith. God started there. And I believe that he has a fondness for Israel as well as for the United States, because the only two countries that were established in the name of God. And this note just says, "Please remind people to pray for Israel. 72 nations are gathering today in Paris to decide how to divide up their land." So let's pray together. Heavenly Father, it is all about you. The world can try to do their stuff, and they will succeed in some cases. But we do know, God, that you are on the throne, that you have a divine plan, and that, God, that you are coming again, and then there will be that time of glorious coming into your kingdom eternally, but also, Lord, judgment for many. And so we ask, Father, that you would help us to have the centrality of Christ in us, so that when people see us, they see hope because of Jesus in us. That when they see our actions, they see love and they see expressions of joy and they see care and compassion because of Christ in us. That Jesus, you would be our all and in all. And Father, we do pray for Israel. We do know that God, you're on the throne. We do know that mankind will try to break up the country. They've been trying to do that ever since it was established when Joshua came across the river. We also know, God, they may have some victories, but they will never have the divine victory. Because, Lord, you have already preordained the rescue of Israel and all of humanity through the powerful name of Jesus Christ. But we pray, Lord, that in this gathering in Paris, that, Lord, there will be confusion. That, Heavenly Father, that these national leaders will not be able to get along in what they want to accomplish. We bind Satan in Jesus' name and demand that he be silent among these leaders. And that, Lord, you will preserve the country of Israel for your glory and demonstrate to the world that you are on the throne. Blessed be the name of God, our Father, Son, Holy Spirit. Be glorified now, Lord, as we worship you with this final song. In Jesus' name, amen.
My Jesus, my Savior, Lord, there is none like you. All of my days I want to praise the wonders of your mighty love. My comfort, my shelter, tower of refuge and strength, let every breath, all that I am, never cease to worship you. Shout to the Lord, all the earth, let us sing. Power and majesty, praise to the King. Mountains bow down and the seas will roar at the sound of your name. I sing for joy at the work of your hands. Forever I'll love you, forever I'll stand. Nothing compares to the promise I have in you. My Jesus, my Savior, Lord, there is none like you. All of my days I want to praise the wonders of your mighty love. My comfort, my shelter, tower of refuge and strength, let every breath, all that I am, never cease to worship you. Shout to the Lord, all the earth, let us sing. Power and majesty, praise to the King. Mountains bow down and the seas will roar at the sound of your name. I sing for joy at the work of your hands. Forever I'll love you, forever I'll stand. Nothing compares to the promise I have. Oh, shout to the Lord, all the earth, let us sing. Power and majesty, praise to the King. Mountains bow down and the seas will roar at the sound of your name. I sing for joy at the work of your hands. Forever I'll love you, forever I'll stand. Nothing compares to the promise I have. Oh, nothing compares to the promise I have. Yes, nothing compares to the promise I have in you.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah, Jesus. Praise your holy name, Father. May we, as we grow in this transformation series, may we truly grow in transformation. Not just in knowledge of, but Lord, in application of, as we surrender ourselves to you in each of these areas we'll be discussing. To you we give the honor and the glory and the majesty forever and ever. In the name of God, the Father, Son, Holy Spirit. Amen. Amen. Thank you for coming. Go in God's peace.